Harper Audio presents The Crown of Dalemark by Diana Wynne Jones, read by Laura Kirman. Part 1. Mitt. Chapter 1. The Earl of Hanart arrived in Aberath 2 days before midsummer. He was bringing the Countess of Aberath a portrait of the Adon to put in her collection. As this was a state visit, he brought his son as well, and a string of his hearthmen, and his arrival caused a rare bustle. A tall man dressed like a shepherd watched it all from high in the hills, where the green roads ran. He had an excellent view from there, not only into the seething courts of the mansion, but of the whole town, the cliffs, the bay, and the boatsheds. The Earl was easy to pick out among the hurrying figures, because he was with a servant carrying the picture. The man watched them go straight to the library, where he knew the Countess was waiting to receive the Earl. Almost immediately, the servant was sent away to fetch someone else. The watcher could see him pushing his way first to the stables, then to the dining hall, and finally to the hearthmen's quarters, where he fetched out a large, gangly person and pointed to the library. The gangly one set off there at a run, on long, gawky legs. The watcher turned away.
"So they did send for this Mitt,"
he said, as if this had confirmed his worst suspicions. Then he looked up and round and over his shoulder, clearly thinking that someone else was standing nearby, watching too. But the green road was empty. The man shrugged and set off walking swiftly inland. About the same time as this man left, Mitt arrived at the top of the library steps, trying not to pant, and pushed open the creaky door.
"Oh, there you are," said the Countess. "We want you to kill someone."
She was never one to beat about the bush. It was almost the only thing Mitt liked about her. All the same, he wondered if he had heard her right. He stared at her long, bony face, which was set slightly crooked on her high shoulders, and then looked at Earl Caryll of Hanart to make sure. Mitt had been 10 months now in Aberath, but the North Dalemark accent there still sometimes made him hear things wrong. Earl Caryll was dark, with a long nose. Everyone said what a likeable man he was, but he was looking at Mitt as grimly as the Countess.
"Didn't you hear?" Earl Caryll asked. "We want someone dead."
"Yes, is this a joke of some kind?" Mitt said, but he could tell from their faces that it was not. He felt cold and disgusted, and his knees shook.
"I gave up killing, I told you," he said to the Countess. "Nonsense," she said. "Why else do you think I had you trained as my hearthman?"
"You would have it that way, not me," Mitt said. "And I never kidded myself you made me learn all that out of love for me." Earl Caryll looked questioningly at the Countess.
"I warned you he was rude," she said.
She leant towards him and they murmured together. Mitt was too disgusted to try to overhear. He looked beyond their two implacable faces at the painting of the Adon propped on an easel behind them. The light was across the canvas from where Mitt stood, in a bluish haze, but the painted eyes caught his, like dark holes in the haze. They looked ill and haunted. The famous Adon had been far from handsome, sickly looking, with lank hair and crooked shoulders. Near on a cripple like the Countess, Mitt thought. She and Earl Caryll both descended from the Adon. She had the shoulders, Caryll had the Adon's long nose. Earlier that day, Mitt would have been thoroughly disappointed to find that the Adon looked like this. Since he came to Aberath, he had heard story after story of the Adon, the great hero who had talked with the undying and lived as an outlaw before he became the last king of Dalemark several hundred years ago. Now he looked from the painting to the two living faces leaning together in the twilight of the library, and he thought, fairy stories. Betty was just as bad as they are.
Well, I ran off from Holand, so I reckon I can run off from Aberath too. Just then, he caught a murmur from Kirill.
Oh, yes, I'm sure that he is.
Sure I am what? Mitt wondered, as they both looked at him again.
We've gone into your history, Carol said to him. Attempted murder in Holland, successful murder in the Holy Islands.
That's a lie, Mitt said angrily. Whatever you think, I never murdered a single soul, and I gave up trying long before I came here.
Then you'll have to force yourself to try again, said the Countess.
Won't you?
And you came on here by boat,
Carol went on, before Mitt could speak.
With Navis Hadson and his children, Hildreda and Inen. In Aberath, the Countess took you in and had you educated.
For my sins, the Countess said unlovingly.
So you see, the North has treated you well,
Earl Kirill said.
Better than most refugees from the South, in fact, both you and your friends. We found Navis, a post as hearthman to Stair of Adenmouth, and we sent Hildreda to study at the law school in Gardale. Have you ever wondered why this was?
As Mitt wondered about it, Kirill added pleasantly,
Why the four of you were separated in this way, I mean.
It was a pleasantness that made Mitt feel like a sack with a hole in it. Everything trickled away through the hole, and his knees almost let him down.
Where's Enon, then? He said. Isn't he with Navis?
No, said the Countess, and we are not telling you where he is. Mitt watched her long jaw shut like a trap.
I used to think, he said, that the earls in the north were good, but you're as bad as the ones in the south. Go to any lengths, all of you. You're telling me to kill someone for you or my friends suffer, right?
Let's just say, if you want to see your friends again,
Kirill suggested.
Well, you're wrong, Mitt said. You can't make me do anything. I don't care two hoots for any of them.
The two implacable faces just looked at him. Mitt managed a careless shrug.
We happen to ride on the same boat, that's all, he said. I swear it.
You swear it? By which of the undying?
Kirill asked. By the one? The piper? The wanderer? She who raised the islands? The weaver? The earth shaker?
Come on, choose which and swear.
We don't swear like that in the south, said Mitt.
I know, said Kirill. So it won't hurt you to swear to me by the earth shaker that Navis and his children mean nothing to you. Just swear, and we'll forget the whole matter.
Their faces tilted towards Mitt. Mitt looked away at the dark painted eyes of the Adon and tried to make himself swear. If Kirill had chosen any other of the undying, he thought he could have done it easily, but not the Earthshaker. And that showed how frighteningly much Kirill knew. Even so, perhaps he could swear about Navis and Hildi, and let on he meant Enon too. Navis, cold fish on a slab that the man was, still didn't seem to like Mitt particularly. And as for Hildi, after her last letter, Mitt could almost swear he hated her. But he had shown he was worried about Enon, like a fool, and there was no way he could even pretend to dislike Enon or let these two earls hurt him.
Is Enon all right? He said.
Perfectly at the moment, said the Countess.
She never told lies. Mitt was relieved, until he realised that she and Kirill both had the same look, satisfied and unsurprised. They knew he had given in. They had expected it.
I warn you, Mitt said. If there's murdering needin' doing, I can see two ripe cases for it here in this room. So who do you want killed? What's so special that you need to go to all this trouble with me to have it done?
Kirill's eyebrows went up. The Countess seemed surprised. Good, Mitt thought. Find out how important it is from how rude they let me be.
Do you take me for a fool? He said. If it was lawful, you both have lawyers to burn, and if it was ordinary, you've hearthmen to do it by hundreds. And I'd lay good money you have spies and murderers better than me any day. So it stands to reason it must be politics, you wanting to lay this on southern scum like me.
You said it, not me, Kirill replied. Politics it is. We want a young lady out of the way. She's very charming and much too popular. The whole of the West Coast, including Dropwater, will follow her as soon as she gives the word.
Flamin' Amit, protested Mitt.
Be quiet, said the Countess. Listen.
She said it like the snap of a steel trap. End of rudeness, thought Mitt, and swallowed what he had been going to say. It hurt, as if he had swallowed an apple whole.
Norith of Credendale, known as Wan's daughter, Kirill said. I expect you've heard of her.
Mitt shook his head, but it was from amazement, because he had indeed heard of Norith, Wan's daughter. The story of the Wan's only human child was one of the many. Many stories he had heard round the small coal fires in Aberath this last winter. He had thought that, like other stories, it was from times long ago. But Kirill, in the most matter-of-fact way, went on to speak of Norith as alive here and now.
Unfortunately, he said, she's extremely well connected. The Credendale family go back to the Adon's daughter, Tanabrid, whose mother was of the Undying. Norith is cousin to Gardale and Dropwater, though Stair's wife at Adenmouth is the aunt who brought her up. And she's a distant cousin of mine, too. And mine, said the Countess. Pity the girl's mad. Mad or not, said Kirill, Norith claims that her father is the One himself. As her mother died when Norith was born, there's no one to contradict her. And this claim gives her a huge following among the ordinary people. She makes no secret that she thinks she's born to become Queen of all Dalemark, North and South.
And that fool in Dropwater backs her, said the Countess.
So that's it, Mitt thought. They're scared for their earldoms. So they get me to stop her and then blame it on the poor South.
Just a minute, he said. If she's who she says she is, no one can do a thing about it. And someone who's from the Undying on both sides isn't going to be easy to kill either.
Quite possibly, Kirill said. That's why we were so interested in what we heard about you from the Holy Islands. Reports from there suggested that you could well ask the Undying to help you.
Mitt stared at him, shocked at how much Kirill knew and how coldly he was prepared to use that knowledge. Kirill leant forwards.
We don't want yet another false king and yet another ruinous uprising, he said.
Mitt saw he really meant it.
We don't want another war with the South. We want Norith quietly stopped before she can lay her hands on the crown.
The crown? Said Mitt. But nobody knows where that is. They tell stories here about how Manaliabrid hid it.
She did, said Kirill.
Norith, said the Countess, says that the One will show her where it is.
Mitt looked from one face to the other and suspected both of them had a fair idea where the crown was hidden.
The girl claims the One talks to her, the Countess added disgustedly. I told you she was mad. She says the One has promised her a sign to prove her claim,
and that this year, at midsummer, she will become queen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.